Today we are going to discuss from the 13th chapter. And the title for the discussion today is The Supreme Truth. Based on the teachings of Srila Prabhupada, this is text 13 to 17 what we are going to cover today. I shall now explain the knowable, knowing which you will taste the eternal. This is beginningless, and it is subordinate to me. It is called Brahman, the spirit, and it lies beyond the cause and effect of this material world. Today, these 3-4 verses are quite technical in nature, but I'd like to explain to them so that we can easily understand. If you remember, in our previous class, we talked about Kshetra and Kshetragna. Kshetra means field, this body. This body is a Kshetra. Like for a farmer, the field of his activity, the land in which he tills the land, cultivates the, grows the crop, is the Kshetra, is the field. So this body is a field of activity for Kshetragna. Kshetragna is the soul. In this Kshetra, there are two Kshetragnas. What are the two Kshetragnas? The soul and the super soul. Now, some of you were there, some of you were not there. The Kshetra comprises of 24 elements. Let's do a quick recap what those 24 elements are. So, 5 gross elements. Earth, air, water, fire, ether. 5 senses, karmendriyas, and 5 jnanendriyas. So we have 5 working senses and 5 knowledge acquiring senses. What we generally talk about senses is jnanendriyas, eyes, ears, nose, tongue, and touch, skin. Through these senses, we acquire knowledge. So it's called jnanendriyas. So we have 5 material elements. We have 5 jnanendriyas. And then we have 5 karmendriyas, 5 working senses. Our hands, legs, anus, genital, and mouth. And then we have 5 sense objects. Like for the eyes, it is rupam. For the tongue, it is taste. For ears, it is shabda. For skin, it is sparsha. And what is left now? For the nose, it is gandha, smell. So it becomes 20. 5 sense objects, 5 working senses, 5 knowledge acquiring senses, and 5 gross elements. 20. Then we have 3 subtle elements, manas, buddhi, and ahankara. That makes it 23. And the 24th element is consciousness under the influence of the modes. Under the influence of contaminated consciousness, rajoguna, tamoguna, satoguna is the 24th element. So these 24 elements, and then there is soul and super soul. And all what we see in this world is interaction of these 24 elements, the soul, super soul, these 24 elements under the influence of kala. Kala is time. So there is Kshetra and there is Kshetragna. Now the Lord is going to explain about the Kshetragna. Who that Kshetragna is, who that supreme knower is, the super soul is. And then he says, if we have a proper understanding of Kshetra and Kshetragna, then we can relish nectar of life. Sometimes people get a feeling that spirituality is all about abnegating, rejecting happiness. It's about voluntarily accepting some pains. As if it is a sin to enjoy life. Maja karna ek paap hai. So a lot of people are, you know, hum maja karna chahte hain. We want to enjoy life. And it appears that those who are practicing spiritual life are against that principle. They don't want to enjoy life. They want to probably suffer, suffer and suffer so that they get mukti. So here it is said, they can enjoy nectar in life. Broadly speaking, there are two kinds of happiness. Material happiness and spiritual happiness. We have discussed this many times in the session. What is the broad distinction, difference between material happiness and spiritual happiness? What is the broad difference? Broad difference. Material happiness is temporary. Spiritual happiness is eternal. Okay, one. Anybody else? Broad difference. Yes. Okay, so you're saying spiritual happiness is all the time happy, including at the time of chanting. But we feel sleepy and we feel tired and we feel bored. We don't experience that. Yes. So you're saying material happiness is, Lord is out of picture. It is all to do with interaction of the kshetra, the senses, sense objects. Yeah? And spiritual happiness is to do with the interaction between the soul and the super soul. Okay. Anybody else? Broad difference between, yes, Deepak. It is hidden. You have to find out. You have to labor hard. Okay, anybody else? Yeah, abhi hum logon ne discuss kiya. It is right. It is temporary and it is eternal. One very, very important distinction for a material happiness and spiritual happiness is, material happiness is nectar in the beginning, poison in the end. Spiritual happiness is poison in the beginning, apparently. Subah uthna, snan karna daily, it's poison. More so in winters. Kumbh Mela mein jana and snan karna sangam mein. Some of the devotees had gone. They said, you know, morning if you touch water, it looks like electric shock. So cold. So it's apparently poison in the beginning. Lot of rules and regulations. You like enjoying, but you're said don't eat it. You are advised to fast where you have a natural inclination or desire to eat anything and everything you want to eat. So it's apparently a lot of restrictions, rules, do's and don'ts. Apparently poison in the beginning, nectar in the end. And only in the human form of life, this is very important for us to appreciate, understand. Only in human form of life we have got the developed intelligence to discern and to keep in abeyance immediate happiness for long-term higher pleasure. And this principle we apply even in our day-to-day life, even if when we are not a spiritualist. I know many people, they are working in good MNCs, but they stop working. They take a bank loan, 20 lakh rupees, get admitted into an MBA college. They have stopped earning. They have taken a break from their career. They have invested 20 lakh rupees, taken the pain of going to a college, studying 8-10 hours a day. Immediately it appears that they are going through a lot of hardships. Yes or no? But long term it is good for them, beneficial for them. So even in our material life, we see many times we, for a long term good, we are willing to take some short term austerities. And in human form of life specifically, to enjoy this nectar, the real nectar, which is spiritual happiness, tapo divyam shuddhyet brahma saukhyam tu anantam. It is said that human life is meant for tapo divyam. Tapo divyam means tapasya. What kind of tapasya? Divyam, divine, not concocted, not one's own mind, one concocts some kind of a tapasya. Divine tapasya, recommended, authorized tapasya. For example, chanting. It is a tapasya. At times we may not like doing it. We may not feel good doing it. At times it may look very boring. Tapo divyam. When we do that tapasya, what will happen? Shuddhyet. We'll get purified. All that kshetra which has become contaminated, the senses are helplessly getting pulled towards sense objects. The consciousness has got contaminated. And the kshetragna is struggling in that kshetra. Tapo divyam shuddhyet. What will happen? Shuddhyet. We'll get purified. And with that purified consciousness, what will we experience? Brahma sokhyam tu anantam. We will experience happiness which is untainted, which is lasting, and anantam, which is eternal. We are eligible for, we are qualified for, we have entitlement for enjoying that kind of happiness. But unfortunately, we have settled for something which is very, very meager. And that material happiness, our Shastra says, it is available. If you analyze, what is that topmost material happiness which people at times even get into scandals? Recently we had Me Too. A lot of people, it's material happiness there. But that happiness is abundantly available even in other life forms. A dog is enjoying that kind of a happiness. The senses coming in contact with the sense objects in the material domain. So, here the Lord is saying one can relish nectar in this life with proper understanding of Kshetra, Kshetragna, and the Supreme Lord, the Super Soul, the Supreme Kshetragna. Now, what about this Kshetragna, the Supreme Knower, the Super Soul? Everywhere are his hands and legs, his eyes and faces, and he hears everything. In this way, the Super Soul exists. So, the Super Soul, the Kshetragna, the soul, is knower of only this field, this body, whereas the Super Soul is knower of all the bodies, the entire creation, both material and spiritual. Abhigna Swarat, he is the supreme knower. He is conscious of everything. Now, how is it possible that a person knows everything? The example is given, just like a sun may be situated in one place in the sky, but it diffuses sunlight everywhere. You might fly to Delhi, and then again when you look up on the sky, you see that sun is there. The same sun in the sky is diffusing heat and light everywhere. Likewise, the same Supreme Lord is present everywhere, in everyone, in every atom as Super Soul. Everywhere are his hands and legs, his eyes and faces, and he hears everything. Material life consists of the understanding that eat, drink, be merry, enjoy life. We are not accountable for our action. Who is seeing? So long as I can beat the law, I can go scot-free, I should be happy. But a devotee understands that I might cheat the law. I might even apparently go scot-free. I might be intelligent enough to break the laws and not get caught, but not with the case of the Supreme Lord. He is watching everything. So for a devotee, for a materialist, he is conscious that I should not get caught. For a devotee, he is more conscious of displeasing the Lord. He has that conscience which always keeps him on the right track. If I do this, it will be very displeasing to the Lord. He is conscious of the pleasure and displeasure of the Lord. One time there was a Gurukul, and typical Gurukul where the disciples go and get trained under the guidanceship or the tutelage or the guidance of a guru. So their training got completed, three of them. And generally we have, even in our academics, you know, after the session gets over, the academic session, we have an exam. So the guru, just to test whether they have learned their lessons sufficiently well, he gave them a final test. And the test was, he gave each one of them an apple in their hand and they said, go and eat this apple and come back. But only one condition you have to keep in mind, that do not eat the apple in the presence of anyone. Eat the apple in a place where no one is watching you. So the disciples, for them, they said, what a simple test. After 2-3 years of all the training, such a simple test the guru has given. So one of them went the backyard of the ashram, Gurukul. There was a forest. And typically in forest, you don't find human beings. He went deep in the forest, ensured that nobody is watching, ate the apple and came back. So he was, you know, big smile on his face. He has, you know, final exam. He has cleared. He has passed. The second one, who was relatively more wise, more intelligent, he said, maybe it's not the human beings which are not watching, but there are many birds, many insects. They also have eyes. They also are living entities. They are watching. So he went deep in the forest, looked for a cave, and when he entered the cave, it was pitch dark. And after entering the cave with a boulder, he made sure that the entry point of that cave is also closed, and it was pitch dark. Even if there are some insects, there's nobody going to watch in that dark, this thing. He ate the apple and came back. Heart of heart, he had this poor fellow, the first one who had come. You know, he has failed the test. I have passed the test because I have eaten the apple where nobody was watching. And late in the evening, the third disciple, he comes back with a sullen face, very disappointed, apple still in his hand. And he was quite dejected that, you know, such a simple test, unfortunately I have failed that test. I couldn't find a place where I could eat the apple and nobody was watching. So then one of them asked, didn't you find a place? He said, wherever I went, I couldn't escape two eyes watching me. So then one of them said, you could have come with me. I went deep inside a cave. It was pitch dark. You could have told me you are not finding the place. I would have taken you there. So I even went in that pitch dark cave. But still, I could not escape those two eyes. So I have come back convinced that there is no place in the world where I can escape the eyes of the Lord. The guru got up and embraced his disciple. You have actually understood the message. You are the realized one. So what brings accountability in the life of a devotee? Why he becomes a good devotee, a sincere devotee, becomes a thorough gentleman? Because he knows that the Lord is always watching him. He always has that conscience. Moment he does wrong, it signals him that yes, he had made a mistake. When he, by mistake, kills an ant, he feels bad. I shouldn't have done it. Now, the Lord is present everywhere. His hands are present everywhere. He is watching everything. He is conscious of everything. That's why in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, patram pushpam phalam toyam yo me bhakta prayachati. If you offer me with love a flower, a fruit, a water, I will accept it. How will he accept? He is there everywhere. We have examples of great devotees who have even done manas puja. Manas puja means even worshipping the Lord in the mind. Because they could not afford to do puja with gross objects. That's why it is said bhavagrahi janardana. The Lord is bhavagrahi. He is more interested in our bhava, in our love, in our devotion. And if we have that, he will accept it. Because he is present everywhere. Present in everything. He is conscious of everything. The super soul is the original source of all senses. Yet he is without senses. Now this is very intricate. He is unattached. Although he is the maintainer of all living beings. He transcends the modes of nature and at the same time, he is the master of all modes of material nature. So here it is said that the super soul is the original source of all senses, yet he is without senses. So there are philosophers who say that this is the word which says that Lord is impersonal. Impersonal means he does not have a form, does not have a body. He is not a person, because person means senses. He doesn't have eyes, he doesn't have ears, he doesn't have nose, he doesn't have tongue, he doesn't have a body, he doesn't have legs, he doesn't have arms, he doesn't have hands. In other words, he is impersonal. But here it is said, the super soul is the original source of all senses, yet he is without senses. Now, how do we understand? The real understanding is his senses are transcendental. It is not material. And hence the Lord is also called Nirguna. Guna means with material qualities. We have material senses made of gross elements. Earth, air, water, fire, ether. The Lord's senses are all spiritual. They are not material. They are untouched by the modes. And hence the Lord is also called Nirguna. This is not to say that he does not have eyes, he does not have a form, he does not have legs. He has no material eyes but sees everything, past, present and future. He has no material eyes. Material body means limitation. Material eyes means I can see only what is within my. Spiritual Lord is transcendental senses. Sat, Chit, Ananda, Vigraha. With his transcendental senses, he can see everything. He can know everything. Now, does that mean the Lord knows past, Lord knows present? This question I have asked earlier also. Again, let me repeat. Some of you are not there. Or there, it could be a revision. The Lord knows the past, Lord knows the present, Lord knows the future. Next week in Gita Live class, will you come or not come? Does the Lord know? Yes or no? How many of us say Lord knows? So in other words, you don't have a free will. It is hard-coded. It's already frozen. You don't have a choice. Next Sunday, who knows, something interesting comes up in your life. Is it the Lord knows the past, Lord knows the present, Lord knows the future? So is the future hard-coded? Yes or no? How many of us feel it is hard-coded? Hard-coded means that is what the church in the 7th century AD believed that all this understanding of karma, the Lord makes a person fatalistic. It's all fate. Sab likha hua yahan pe. Working hard, all this is no meaning because it's all fate. Ultimately fate, destiny is the one which overrules everything. And at times it made a person lazy. Agar meri kismat mein pass hona likha hai, to ho jaunga. Agar Bhagwan ki, Bhagwan chahte hai main Gita life mein aaun, to aaunga. Agar chahte hai main TV dekhun, to TV dekhunga. Very nice philosophy, isn't it? So does the Lord know the future and is it hard-coded? Yes or no? What is the right answer? The answer is both yes and no. Why? The example is given that when a cow is tied to a pole with a rope, if the rope which is tying the cow to a pole is 5 meters long, the cow has freedom of moving in a 5 meter radius freely. But beyond 5 meter, the rope restricts that cow. Beyond 5 meters. Am I right? Yes or no? All of us are bound and all of us have an invisible rope tying us. It could be 3 meters, it could be 5 meters, it could be 10 meters, it could be 0 meters. If the rope length is 0 meters, what does that mean? You are so restricted, the example is given like a tree. It's just standing in one place, cannot move. It's a living entity like you and me. It's an atma. It's just standing there, cannot move. It's raining, its thunderstorms are coming. It cannot move. And so here we have example of a living entity where length of the rope is practically zero. Cannot move. Cannot do anything. So we also are bound and free to different degrees. Some people are so bound, the Lord can very clearly say, nahin aayega wo. Nahin aa sakta because he is so bad. And some of us, just like the cow, has a freedom within 5 meter radius. We are also free. We can exercise our free will and choose to come or not come. And the Lord knows. So the answer is both yes and no. It is not that fatalistic means everything is hard-coded. We have a free will. Basis on the choices we make every moment, our future destiny is changing. Everything is not kismat mein likha hua hai, so I am just a piyada, I am just a puppet. I have no choice, nothing I can do. It's all written in my fate. That's wrong. Every moment we have a choice. If we make the right choices, the length of the rope increases. If we make wrong choices, the length of the rope decreases. If we continuously make wrong choices, the length of rope becomes practically zero. So the more the length of the rope, the Lord has given that exercise of free will to the living entity, he can choose. Just like even in the father and the Lord, just like a father gives some pocket money to a child, if he uses it properly, the father will give more money. If he knows that the son has taken that money and gone to a bar and spoiled that money and got into bad habit, he'll restrict that supply. So George Washington, who was the president of the United States, was asked, what's the secret of your success? He was very successful, president of United States. So somebody asked him, what's the secret of your success? You become president of United States, almost like the number one man in the world. So he said, I work, I pray as if everything is dependent on the Lord. And then with a smile, he says, I work as if everything is dependent on me. We sometimes act in the pendulum. Bhoga, tyaga. Everything is dependent on me. And sometimes we go to the other extreme. Everything is dependent on God. The right understanding is, we depend on Lord in our activities, but we do our duty. That's why there's a verse which says, karmane vahadikar ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phala heturbhur. Do not think yourself the cause of the result of your activities. And further Krishna says, and do not be attached to not doing your duty, because what motivates us to do our actions is the results. If the results, you're saying don't be attached to results, then what is the motivation to act? Therefore Krishna says, do not be attached to not doing your duty. So we have to do our duty with a lot of enthusiasm, but simultaneously depend on the Lord. Have that feeling that not a blade of grass moves without His sanction. That doesn't mean not a blade of grass moves without, and let me go and sleep. He will move the grass. Not a blade of grass moves without His sanction, but I will have to do my duty. He lives within the heart of the living being and He knows past, present and future. And the future is not static, it is dynamic. Based on the choices what we make every moment, our future is changing. Just like even for that matter, a weather forecast, they can forecast what's going to be the weather one day from now, 2 days from now, 1 week from now, based on the data in the past. The Lord, you can imagine, just like these days, computers, they're gained in their computing abilities. Imagine the Lord seeing the past and the way we are exercising the future can easily know where we are headed, what's going to be our future. And that future is not static. The more we are tied, the more the length of the rope is less, the future is almost predictable. In other words, the Lord is not impersonal. He has eyes, He has legs, He has hands, but not material hands, not material eyes, not material senses. And they are uncontaminated by material nature. Now, Lord Buddha, when He came, there was a purpose. He is the incarnation of the Lord. He came and rejected the Vedas because people in the name of Vedas were killing, doing a lot of animal sacrifices and justifying killing in the name of Vedas. So, Lord Buddha came and rejected the Vedas. In one sense, if you see Buddhist philosophy without any disrespect, he is the incarnation of the Lord who has come for a purpose. It is atheistic in nature. Doesn't believe in the existence of soul. So Lord Buddha, that philosophy became very much permeated in the society, and King Ashoka, when he embraced Buddhism and he did his work to spread Buddhism all over the world, then Shankaracharya came, who is incarnation of Lord Shiva. Now imagine people are in this one stage of understanding of what life is. God does not exist. This body is all in all. This body is made of material elements. Nirvana is all we are suffering because of this material body. And dismantling of this material elements means Nirvana. Somehow this is the gist. So Shankaracharya, knowing that from this level where people are believing in atheistic understanding of life, he cannot give the highest understanding. So you have to take to the next level. So he preached impersonalism. The Lord has no hands. The Lord is there, but he has no hands. He has no legs. He is impersonal Brahman. Now for a person who is at this level, for him to accept this level of understanding is relatively easy. For a person who is at that level, to climb that step is relatively easy. For that person to climb here is relatively tough. Why do we have staircase? Because a person can gradually go to the next higher level. So Shankaracharya, finally, after having preached impersonalism also, finally, he also told Bhaj Govindam Mudmate. Worship Govinda. And still there are some of his followers who said, actually, those who are Mudmate, they will Bhaj Govindam. Mudmate, those who are foolish, those who are fools, will do Bhaj Govindam. Actually, Govinda is not there. Which is again an interpretation. So the Lord has eternal form, Sat Chit Ananda Vigraha. His Vigraha, his form is not material. What kind of form he has? It's full of eternity, knowledge and bliss. He is full of all opulence, he is the proprietor of all wealth and he is owner of all energy. He is the maintainer of all living entities and is a witness of all activities. Text 16. The Supreme Truth. So this is the Supreme Truth. Who is the Supreme Truth? The absolute Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Samam Bonam. The cause of all causes. Everything exists because of Him. The entire creation has come from Him. He is the maintainer. He is the annihilator. The Supreme Truth exists both internally and externally, in the moving and non-moving. He is beyond the power of material senses to see or to know. The Lord is also called Adhokshaja. Adhokshaja means He is beyond our sense perception. With our blunt material senses, we cannot perceive Him. That's why many people say, there is no God. I cannot see Him, I cannot touch Him, I can't feel Him, so there is no God. Although far, far away, He is also near to all. So He is within, He is without. He is in the moving and non-moving. He is beyond the power of our material senses to perceive Him. Although far, far away, He is also near to all. The Supreme Truth is residing both outside and inside in every living being. Inside as the Super Soul. Paramatma, He is residing in every atom, and outside as a Supreme Lord, all-pervading, omnipotent, omniscient. He is present both in the material world and in the spiritual world. Although He is far, far away, still He is near to us. Now sometimes people may subscribe to, yes, there is spiritual world, Lord is there in Golok Vrindavan, Lord is there in Vaikuntha planets. Maybe in the material world here, you know, Lord is not there. Therefore, there is so much of misery. There is so much of pain. There is so much of, you know, we are suffering because Lord is not there. It's not there. Lord is very much there. Sometimes people also subscribe to the idea there is so much of misery in this world because the Lord has gone away. Things have gone out of His control. Out of frustration, He has left. Chalo ab, jo karna karo ab. Nahi sunte meri. It's not true. He is there with us. We cannot see or understand Him with our material senses. The example, a crude example is given, just like in the milk there is butter, there is ghee. We cannot see it with our eyes. But following the right process, you can take it out. Now, as I mentioned, a lot of people using, He is beyond sense perception. If we try to understand about the Lord, who He is, using our speculation, using our own material logic, using our own limited intelligence, we can come to a wrong conclusion. That's why it is important that we get the right understanding through our shastras, through great acharyas, coming in disciplic succession. If the Lord is all present, we have in our experience that a person is limited by time and space. So if the Lord is all present, means he is not a person. It's a material logic. There is so much of misery in this world, and Lord is supreme controller. Not a blade of grass moves without his sanction. Because so many things are going wrong here, therefore Lord is not there. These are all material logics. You are there because I am able to see you. I am not able to see the Lord, that means Lord is not there. So with this material logic, material rational, we will definitely come to a wrong understanding. And many times people also, like I said, fatalistic theory, everything is not a blade of grass moves without Lord's sanction, so let me relax. Agar hona hoga to ho jayega. One time there was a priest. He prayed, oh Lord, please protect me. And there was a weather forecast. According to forecast, it's going to rain very heavily. And there was a possibility the entire village in which the church was there will get inundated with water. Floods will come. So there was a forecast. But the priest said, no Lord, please protect me, please save me. He ignored the weather forecast and he refused to go away from that village. You know, there was a forecast and people started evacuating that village. So he did not leave, he just kept on praying. And then actually it started raining and the whole village started flooding with water. Even the water entered the church and this priest was praying. Oh Lord, please protect me. Finally, when the water had almost, you know, inundated the church, the priest was holding on and, you know, praying. Someone came in a boat also and said, now the village is getting flooded. Please, if you want, come inside the village. Let's escape from this place. He said, no, the Lord will protect. Lord will protect, and continued praying. So the boatman had to return back disappointed. I have told him, I even offered help, I even offered him, he can come in the boat. He refused. And somehow it so happened, the water kept on rising, and the priest had no option but to go to the top of the church and cling on to the cross which was there on the top of the church. And said, Lord, please protect, Lord, please protect. And finally he saw in the sky there was a helicopter. And that helicopter threw a staircase and says, please hold on to the case and come up. He said, no, the Lord will protect, the Lord will protect, Lord is our Savior. And even that was not heard. Finally, unfortunately, the whole village got flooded, including the church got submerged, and the priest also died. So because he was quite pious, he went to the heaven and met the Lord. He said, Lord, what is this? I prayed so long, so many, so fervently. Please save me. But you know, you didn't answer my prayers. I had to finally die. So he said, I sent you a forecast. You did not listen. I sent you a boat. You did not listen. I sent you even a helicopter to save you, but you did not listen. What can I do? So in other words, the Lord is very active in our lives. Unfortunately, when we are materially overwhelmed, we are not able to hear the Lord. We are not able to experience the reciprocation of the Lord. It is said that the Lord is Shaktiman and the Lord has his Shaktis. We are interested more in the Shaktis than the Shaktiman. When Duryodhan was asked, what do you want? You want my army or you want me? Duryodhan was very happy. I want Shakti. I want the army. What will I do with the Shaktiman? Arjuna was interested in Shaktiman. Because Shaktiman is never without his Shakti. A Shaktiman is always with the Shakti. So a devotee is more interested in the Shaktiman than in the Shakti. Some people are interested in worshipping only Lakshmi, but may not be interested in Narayana. Ravana was interested in Sita, was not interested in Ram. A question to all of you. Should we do Lakshmi Puja? Yes or no? How many of us say we should do Lakshmi Puja? Is Lakshmi Puja right or wrong? I mean, it's a very blunt question I'm asking, because we know in India we have an age-old tradition. We do Lakshmi Puja, we do Saraswati Puja, we do... Is it right or wrong? How many of us say it is right? How many of us say not required? It's not just worship Shaktiman and that's enough. There's nothing wrong if we worship Lakshmi with the right understanding. The right understanding is Lakshmi is consort of Narayana. Bless me with prosperity so that I can serve Narayana. The wrong understanding is bless me Lakshmi so that I can enjoy you. That mentality is Ravana's mentality. I want to enjoy Sita. If you want blessings of Lakshmi and you want to enjoy Lakshmi, keeping Lord in the side, the mentality is that of a Ravana. Will be ruined in the long term. Nothing wrong in worshipping Lakshmi, but with the understanding Lakshmi is consort of Narayana. Let me be blessed with Lakshmi so that I can serve Lord Narayana. Both Ravana also wanted Sita. Hanuman also wanted Sita. Yes or no? Hanuman went all the way to Lanka to get Sita. Even Ravana was wanting Sita. Nothing wrong in wanting Sita. Yes? But one wanted Sita to enjoy. And we call him Ravana, demon. And we worship Hanuman because he also wanted Sita for Lord Ramachandra. So if we worship Lakshmi with the mentality, let me be blessed with prosperity, and I am nowhere having Narayana in my consciousness, that's not right. Nothing wrong in being prosperous. Nothing wrong in being blessed by Lakshmi. But what is wrong is we forget Narayana when we are blessed with Lakshmi. Devotee who has developed love of the Supreme Lord, who has developed Premanjana Chaturita, he can perceive the Lord. He can experience the reciprocation of the Lord. For him, Lord is not just a matter of blind belief or some kind of a faith. Although the super soul appears to be divided, he is never divided. He is situated as one. Although he is the maintainer of every living entity, it is to be understood that he devours and develops all. Now, the Lord is situated in everyone's heart. So, is that mean that he is divided? One small portion of the Lord is there in your heart, one portion of the Lord in my heart, one portion of the Lord in his heart. Is he divided? He is present in everyone, in everything, yet he is undivided. How? Again, crude example, the sun is in the sky. If you go to Delhi, you see the sun is still in the sky. You go to Los Angeles, the sun is still in the sky. The same sun appears in Los Angeles, the same sun appears in New Delhi, same sun appears in Mumbai. Same Supreme Lord is present in my heart, in your heart, in everyone's heart. Supreme Lord, although is a maintainer of every living entity, devours everything at the time of annihilation. The Kala is working under his direction. Mrityu sarvaharas chaham, I am the all-devouring death. Kala, time factor, which devours everything in due course of time, is an agent of Supreme Lord. Can we have one more story? How many of us want a story? Okay. Akbar and Birbal story? Vaja. So one time, Akbar was in the Darbar. All the ministers, you know, typical, the assembly was on. And one person comes in and gifts Akbar a very intricately carved ivory fan. Ivory fan. So gift to Akbar, and Akbar took that fan and, you know, he used the fan for a while, and Birbal was sitting next to him. He threw the fan at him and said, Birbal, this fan is for you. Give this fan to someone who is a greater fool than you. In the whole assembly, in front of everyone, indirectly he told Birbal, you are a fool. He said, give this fan to someone who is a greater fool than you. So Birbal, as we all know, was quite intelligent. So he kept quiet. He waited for the right time. So years rolled by, and a time came when Akbar became quite old, and he was practically sick on the deathbed. So Birbal went to see Akbar, and then he saw he was quite despondent, quite sad. So he said, Your Majesty, looks like you're not feeling well. What has happened? You look quite sullen, quite disappointed. He said, yeah, now that inevitable journey, I have to go for that inevitable journey. Soon the agents of death will come and I'll have to go with them. So then Birbal said, sir, I'm sure which journey you're talking about. You're not well. Then he said, you fool, again, you fool, that inevitable journey which all of us have to eventually embark on. Soon the angels of death will come and we'll have to leave. So then Birbal said, sir, I'm sure you would have prepared for that journey. So that is the sad part. Unfortunately, I have not prepared for it. And very soon I have to embark on that journey. So Birbal took that fan from his hand and said, sir, this fan actually should be with you. He said, you are knowing that you have to embark on this inevitable journey, still you did not prepare for it. Who could be a greater fool than you? So human form of life affords us a wonderful opportunity to understand who we are, where we have come from. Die in knowledge with the right understanding of where we are heading, what are the laws which are operating in this world. Our scriptures say that one who has taken birth as a human being and dies like a cat and a dog in ignorance, he is a miser. What is the meaning of miser? Miser means he has a lot of wealth, but he is reluctant to spend that money. A person who has got this human body, he has a great ability to understand these things, but if he dies in ignorance, like cat and dog, they also die, we also die, we can die conscious of Lord, with the understanding of Lord, with the remembrance of Lord. But if we die like cat and dog, we are called a miser. We have wasted this human form of life. When there is creation, he develops all, and at time of annihilation, he devours everything. This world has come into being because of him. He is creator. He maintains it and eventually he destroys it.